Okay? So, happy Sabbath, everybody. All right. All praises to the Most High in Christ for bringing us here in the Spirit to learn about how to worship the Most High and how to follow the anointed Savior of Israel, Yahushua, whom the world calls Jesus Christ, and how to learn to grow in this ministry, constantly edify ourselves first and then the body of Christ, okay, which is the people of Israel, okay? So, before we get started, let's get something in Psalms. Send out praises to the Most High. Psalms 135. Hey, shalom, sister.
Shalom.
All right, so first one we'll get, instead of 135, we'll go to Psalms 133. And then once you get that, I want you to get 1 Corinthians 14. And bookmark that so we can go right to it. All right, come on. Psalms 133:1. Okay. Psalms 133:1, it says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." So David during his time is speaking on experience, something that we all got to remember. That's why, although it's true of us, it's going to be so many of us that scattered throughout the world with different abilities, different measures of the Spirit. Everything that we speak and everything that we teach, our whole life is a great big ball of experience. And so when we come together, it forms that brotherly love, it forms that sisterly love, it forms the unity. And in David's time, he saw and knew that. Even David in his greatness, he still humbled himself constantly, over and over and over. He didn't feel that he was so high that he had the complete package. Why is this being said to all of us? Because you are the servants of the power of Israel. You are the servants of the Most High. So you have to be an example of the greatness of the Most High in spirit, in humility, in truth, sincerity, and honesty. But it takes unity. And that's what you got to realize. Never look down on a man or a woman because of their weaknesses, but instead encourage them and be charitable and edify them and teach them and be an example. And if it be the Lord's will, because when you really get to know and understand how the Most High works, you're going to realize that all the gift come down from the Father of lights. Anyway, everything that a man or a woman or a child has, that ability, that gift come from the Most High. And it's nothing man can do to destroy that. Man can't root that out the earth. Man tried to punish us. Man has raped and robbed, murdered us, burned us, and killed us. fed us, poisoned and misled and guided us, gave us tradition and philosophy. But the bitter truth is that man did that to those whom the Most High wanted those things done to. Do I need to repeat that again? Man did those brutal things unto the rebels. So when I tell you that the Most High is merciful and grace and graceful and forgiving and loving and caring, it is. Because you can look throughout history and look throughout time, and that person that's hanging from the tree ain't you. That person that was raped ain't you. That person that didn't live in the shack in the bitter cold and had the children taken, that wasn't you. So when the Most High bring us together and tell you to unify yourself, the only way that you're going to unify yourself is through what John, what Christ taught in John 15 about that brotherly love. It ain't just words. You got to get your mind together to where the first and foremost you concerned about who? Yourself, the man in the mirror, the woman in the mirror. And every day that you fall short, you got something to work on. And every day a brother or sister come to you and speak to you and talk to you about how to improve and how to get better, guess what? That's the Most High giving you something, giving you more. If it was a brother come to you and say, here go $50, you're going to take it. Here go $10, you're going to take it. Well, take that advice that the brother give you. Take that instruction that the sister give you and actually go do it. Okay? So, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. When you get a group of brothers and sisters that can do that, you form the brotherhood. It is like the precious ornament upon the head. Well, we know where that comes from. Whose head was really anointed? Christ's head. See that in the Gospels in Matthew, Luke, and John. The sister Mary Magdalene, she went and anointed the Savior's head, the Lord's head, and gave him some comfort. It spilled all over him, though. Even went down to his feet. But at the same time, that unity that she was coming on one accord with him, her disposition was what? Like, you can't tell me nothing? Nah. Her disposition, she had no disposition. She was broke. Her spirit was broke. That's why she wiped his feet with the hairs of her head, crying and weeping. Not because she didn't want him to die. He had to die. If she didn't want him to die, Christ would have rebuked her, because that's an evil thing for him not to die for Israel. What did he do to Peter? Get thee hence. Get back. So it wasn't about that. It was about everything that he had given to her, which was correction, which was instruction, which made her better. And now, was they like-minded? Yes. Was they spiritually on the same level? No. But they were like-minded. And that's why she followed them. So that mind got to get in us. Okay? That's the unity that Yahushua is looking for when it comes to serving and worshiping the Father of Heaven. So it's like the precious ornament upon the head that run down upon the beard, it says even Aaron's beard, and went down to the skirts of his garment. So I'll give you an example of Aaron, but we've talked about Christ and how when the ointment hit him, hit his head to comfort him, it went all over. So that's an example right there to show you how the oil get down to his feet. It went all over. So because of these things, Psalms 134:1, it says, Behold, bless ye the Lord, all ye his servants of the Lord. Okay? Which by night stand in the house of the Lord. So we bless the Most High and be grateful and thankful for the Most High because he called us from the world into the glorious truth. From those ways that would have got us killed. Why was the woman crying? Because she could have been dead body somewhere in a ravine, washed up in the river, overdosed on drugs. Yeah. So that's how we, and I said, and those of you that have not done those things, be really blessed the Most High because now you have the path to avoid those things because destruction is real. And if you stretch your hand out, the Lord say, whether him like it, he going to get it. Now you stretch your hand out to deal drugs and to prostitute yourself. You say, I'm going to be a glamour. I'm going to be a glory. I got a fat old rump on me. I got a nice round butt. And you want to show it off, the Most High going to infest it with diseases. Or give you a brutal man that feed on you and use you and addict you to alcohol and drugs. Or you might just end up in the beast. The beast of America. You might just end up in the system. All avenues of destruction, man, that none of them lead to eternal life. And that's why when David is telling you to bless the Most High and praise the Most High, because once you corrupt yourself, once you destroy yourself, there's a big gulf. Like Abraham told in the spirit, he told the rich guy, there's a big gulf between you and us, between you and them. You can't pass over that. It ain't no rewind in the hands of time. It ain't like that. So the best thing that you can do is be grateful that the Most High called you into this truth, giving you a spirit to be faithful, putting you a part of this unity. Don't despise your brethren. That's evil right there. Don't despise correction. How they tell me what to do. That's evil right there. So bless the Lord, ye servants of the Lord, which stand in the house of the Lord. Verse 2, lift up your hands in the sanctuary and bless ye the Lord. So when we send in our prayers, you have to be serious. You have to make the plunge. You have to be fully committed. Because this is your profession. Now, we went through that class or two ago. This is your priority. This is the main thing that you're alive for. This worship of the Most High. You are become a holy priesthood to bring forth fruits unto the Lord. Yes, first and foremost, your actions, and then to help a brother and help another sister. You're masquerading as a doctor. You're masquerading as a store clerk. That can carry the job. This is first. Every man, woman, and child. The scripture says your sons and daughters shall prophesy. So start. Start applying the scriptures so that you can make a change and a difference to the person next to you and stop being the little gremlin if you're a child. Stop being stubborn and haughty and rebellious if you're a woman. Stop being useless and worthless and unprofitable and deadbeat if you're a brother, if you're a man, and start walking like you're the prophets, the sons and daughters of the Most High. That's how you praise the Most High. That's the only way you're going to get salvation. Like we said before, Christ was a carpenter. You didn't see how he advertised these big construction company and this and that. 90% of his actions was based on the world, but you knew he knew the scriptures. That's madness. How about 100% of information about you is all scriptures, and people might not know what type of job you got? That's when you committed unto the Lord. And if they diligently search to find out, they see that, okay, you got an honest trade, but why ain't you promoting? Because you're not of the flesh. They that are the flesh do mind what? There you go. The things that are of the flesh. But they that are the spirit do mind what? There you go. See, that's the scriptures there. So in case you think, you know, why are you saying that? That's the scriptures, man. Let's, it's a little bit more. 35, Psalms 135. And one, praise ye the Lord, praise ye the name of the Lord. Well, what is his name? Okay. I spent time last night. Like I said, I've been saying this for years. I deal with a lot of different people, and some never make it to that door, but that's okay. Because my job is not my will. You got a lot of different people. They don't call the Most High Yahweh. A lot of different titles. Don't you look at those people as being wicked and evil? Because vengeance belongs to who? You? I doubt it. I doubt it. You scarcely being saved yourself. So you better bring forth acts of charity. Now, is it good when we say the same thing? Yes. But we say the same thing how? What makes us say the same thing? And I need a scripture. So everybody, you go start searching through the scriptures. What helps us say the same thing? Now, though you might not come up with what I come up with, but you still may come up with an answer. But you know we get in, our minds begin to gel when we come up with the vicinity of the same precepts. What would help us? Matthew 16. I wonder was anybody going there. Matthew 16. Always remember this. This will help you be charitable. Matthew 16, verse 13. Gosh, I've never started your recording, brother. But I, you know what? You can always go to the site. And so if you want to, when we stop it, and you go there. Oh, you want to pick up here. Stop it, okay. We ain't got into the lesson yet. Yeah, well, that's just appetizing. All right. Oh, crazy. All right, so Matthew 16, verse what? 13. So when Christ came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, so even if I were to say Jesus, that wouldn't hurt me. Because you got some people that's all they know. And this was something that I dealt with a brother, and he said that he had been confused for a long time. So the Most High raising us up to be prophets of the Lord, his apostles, male and female. The Most High don't want to see no useless women. And all you think you're supposed to do is be somebody's wife and be somebody's mother. You are nuts. You got a lot of lost people. You turn on the TV and the Israelite women tricked out. And the only thing you think your job is to shut your mouth and go in front of the stove. You're useless. If you can't, let me make sure I say it right. You have to do more than just be a wife. You've got to be somebody's sister. You have to be somebody's example. You have to be somebody's lamp. Now, you may not think that you're going to put a dent in it, but that's your thoughts. The scripture says the earth is, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are the thoughts of the Most High. So his intention with you, for what you see, it may not be that big, but the way the Most High views, he knows what's going to come from your example and the person that gets that example from you and what's going to grow from there. Just like a small seed, and it grows into a huge tree. Should the seed envy the tree? They from the same, you know, they come from the same thing. They are the same. They are one. All right. So when Christ came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, say, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So who are people, who are they saying that I am? Because we was in the Psalms, and it says, praise ye the name of the Lord, praise ye. So I have brothers, you know that Lord means bow, but charitable, I just kind of pumped them with the scriptures. But on the inside, I was like, not to me. That's not what it means to me. It only means that that's the head of me. But most people will try and use other books, in which for informative purposes can be resourceful to prove certain things. You can't make a full-time ministry out of other books. Not when the Bible says, seek ye out the book of the Lord and read. Seek ye out of this book and read. None shall want her mate. So how are you going to compete with that? So anytime you base a ministry and you constantly bringing that in, everybody that's following his book that the Most High oversaw, you're going to be going, you're going to be fighting against it. You're going to be fighting against the Most High. You're going to be fighting the Most High in doing that. Because you're going to be confusing a lot of people. And that's one of the things that we're going to get into. Maybe it's just coming a little bit early before our lesson in Ephesians 3. You are not being taught to confuse people. We are being taught to edify people. Don't have a doubt in your mind that you are the prophet of the Most High. Don't question yourself. Don't discussion James say, what? Doubt nothing. Wavering. Don't waver. You don't let nobody, no matter what you hear, no matter who you hear from, you don't let nobody take that apostleship from you, because Christ himself ordained you to bring forth these fruits that you bring forth. If it wasn't meant, you wouldn't be here. That's how you know. Along with the actions that you bring forth, the commitment that you have made in your life, show you that the Most High have chosen you out of this world to bear his name and bring forth fruit. Okay? Some different amounts. But stop being shook. Stop being, because it's a lot. Even during the time of Christ, you had philosophers. You had doctors of the law. You had scribes and Pharisees, which was a lot more than him and his disciples, which were his friends. But you might have thought that the majority ruled at that time. Just like if you're not careful, you may be deceived into thinking that the majority rules. Okay? No. Those that do the will of the Father in heaven, that stay in the scriptures. The Savior said, he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Out of your belly shall flow these words. You're going to have the ability to change and help for the good and for the better. Men, women, and children, and family lives. That's your job. That's what you're looking for. The ability to do that. And it's out here because he said in Luke 10, the harvest is truly great. But the labors of what? Few. Therefore, you know that it was more of the wrong side than it was that was really following the will of the Most High, of sticking to this. And some people don't like that, believe it or not. Some people don't like for you to stick with the basics of the scriptures. I run into the situation all the time, and I resolve it within 10 seconds. I got a 10-second little rule within myself, because I'm not going to argue with you, I'm not going to strive with you. And it ain't about me or you, it's about the scriptures. And the conclusion is, if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. If you keep the commandments, the Most High will show you the rest. Okay? So he's asking his disciples, verse 14. And they said, some say that thou, John the Baptist, other Elias, and others Jeremiah, are one of the prophets. So now, I got a question for you. If his disciples are saying that he could be John the Baptist, what's the state of John the Baptist? Okay, Elijah. What's the state of John the Baptist? What was he? Did he go out of town and did he return?
No.
Okay. Or was he visiting and he's still there and they don't know if he came back, or did he grow up and there's rumors and nobody knew how he looked, and so when he come around they're like, this is John. What is the state of John the Baptist? Talk to me. What's the state? Nah, not where he lives from. I don't know, is there another word that I can use to help him understand what I'm asking? What is the state of John the Baptist? What is his whereabouts? Where's his whereabouts? He's dead. Yeah, he's dead. So you might be wondering, like, because I'm going to go somewhere and come right back. Okay, what about Elias? Elias is Elijah the prophet. He's dead too. Jeremiah, he's dead. So if they are thinking that he could be one of them, they also letting you know that the ability that the Father in heaven has to rise up his servants, the prophets, and bring them in time period anytime he wants to, is something that the Most High does. Because they expecting that he can be one of those prophets. Do we understand that or not understand that? That those prophets can live again. Do we see that? Because they think that Jesus Christ, Yahushua, that man there, it could possibly want to be one of those guys, even though he's not. But that's what they think. So they're telling you that the possibility of those servants being risen, born, and teaching to do the will of the Most High again is highly possible, right? So stop questioning yourself. Now, I'm not saying that you are John the Baptist or that you are Elias or you are Mary Magdalene or you are Mary the Mother of Christ or you are Judith, Susanna, Rebecca, none of those women. I can't put any labels and any titles, but you got to wake up and you got to realize that your role in this earth is more important than you could have ever imagined. And that you got to shift all the weight and all the forefront to the scriptures, because this is what's going to help you to gain that glorious and amazing, astonishing prize of eternal life. Man, we're going to be immortal. Yes, we're going to be immortal. You are never, ever going to die. You are never, ever going to be sick. And wealth beyond measure, like the dust on the ground, it'll be so much that it'll probably be useless. Your servants will only admire it, but you, it'll be natural. But you have to wake up and do this work in order to achieve that prize. That's why it's so valuable. That's why it's so valuable. And it's nothing. That's nothing for the Most High to do that, because He loved us and He chose us. That's what I'm saying. You can't be an ordinary woman. You can't just stand in front of the stove and say, I'm going to be somebody's woman. You're useless like that. So I try to refrain myself from saying things that are offensive. But the reality of this formality is that you got to act like you're the servant of the Most High. And the Most High want the men of Israel to stop putting a gender on His servants. Because we did that 10, 15, 20 years ago, and it caused the women to stumble. They stayed carnal-minded. They stayed fleshly and worldly. And that's not the mind state of the servant of the Most High. But there's always order in all the churches, so you still stay in the scriptures. But we don't duck and dodge and weave precepts for our own benefit, like they do in the flesh. Okay? So, verse 15. He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? So he's asking, who are you saying that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ. You are the Christ. So you're not them. You're somebody different. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Yehoshua answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah. For here's our answer. Always remember this. For flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. So please, as a servant and prophet of the Most High in Christ, don't argue with somebody about labels and titles and what the Most High goes by. Why is that? Based on the answer that the scriptures just brought out. Yashal.
Because they're not going to understand it.
Based on the scriptures. Just stay with the scriptures. Yes, I'll let him. Go ahead.
Because the Most High has no revealed this
one. Okay. Duada. I'm not saying that's wrong, but I'm trying to people respond directly. People, Christ said, my sheep hear my voice. So if you ever want to deal with spirits, use the scriptures. It seems like to snap them in or out. If it doesn't work on them, that doesn't mean the scriptures don't work. That means that spirit's not listening. So what I'm looking for, I'm trying to teach you through the spirit out to say the precept. Because if you do it here, you're going to do it somewhere else. And that person's going to stand corrected. Okay? That person's going to stand corrected. Okay? Use the precepts once more, brother. Verse 17. What does it say?
Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven.
So what's the answer? You don't look at me. Look in verse 17. For
flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee.
Exactly. For flesh and blood. So when you run into a situation to where somebody is saying something different, remember? Okay. Understand that flesh and blood have not revealed that thing. So there's no reason to fight with them. There's no reason to have a contention with them. Do we all understand that?
And that's something that we're supposed to understand when we deal with somebody who don't understand.
There you go.
And we know that the Most High has revealed it unto us.
Right. Okay, now, before that, if you understand that and you've exhausted all avenues and you got to the root of the matter, when I say the root, meaning actually the root, which is ancient Hebrew. And that's why the pronunciation of Yahusha, to what I've known for quite a while, that's the root of the Hebrew that's here on the earth that we understand. So I feel blessed to have understood that. Okay? So now, But to go in and have a problem with somebody over that, that's what you don't do, ever. Because there's something that got to come from you where people will know that you are the servant of Christ. What is that? And I need a scripture. Your actions, by the way that you deal with a person, they're going to know, oh, my God, this is somebody that come from the Most High. This is somebody that Christ is dealing with. You, what is that? Okay, Josh.
Maybe 2 Timothy 2 or 14.
Let's see what you got.
And if, and like you said, a person, we deal with a person, they don't understand that the spirit that this person have on them is of the Lord, because it's something that, that we're not going to do, or how we deal with it. That's the tool that we use. It's one of the fruits of that can shed light on what's coming up.
Okay.
Look, someone that's answering that.
Not quite. A lot, most times things are not wrong, but not quite. I think we're going to try and force this one.
Okay.
But you can read and tell us what you see.
Okay. Well, 2 Timothy 2 and 13, if we believe nothing. Well, I'm not 13. That these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord, that they try not about words to no profit, but to the subversion of the hearers. So Paul is saying that this is something that we're supposed to remind each other, that when we deal with people, you know, and teaching them Christ, that we don't get caught up in striving back and forth about, like, for example, when we're dealing with the name of the Most High. Because a lot of people call them many different things, but we know through the Spirit of Most High showed us what His name is, and we believe that. So what we're not going to do is strive back and forth about the name of the Most High, like what Paul was saying, strive back and forth about words to no profit, because the person that don't understand it, it's not going to be profitable for them because they don't understand. And if you strive back and forth with them, it's also setting a bad example for them, because going back and forth is not going to profit them or profit you. If anything, it's going to cost the person not to deal with you at all.
Okay. Okay. So that's fine. Nothing wrong with that. Let's further expound. You got something, Water?
James D.
Okay, James 3:18.
It says that as the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. So whenever we're dealing with people and matters and things like that in the scripture, either like situations like you're dealing with names and something like a person not understanding. Your fruit, which is righteousness, you're going to be sowing peace. You ain't going to count against the brother, not that you're going to smite them because they don't understand, but you're going to be trying to sow peace with them. As far as what they don't understand, you're going to take the load and still not so much as cause some type of separation, strife, but you're going to kind of sow in peace. You're going to suffer with the person. You know, and
trying to
help them understand what's
going on.
Okay.
Martha had a tool, like pray that the Most High should be prayerful. Pray the Lord should.
Right. So, now, all right, those things are true. Let's get this. Let's get the help with this. John 13. John 13:34. John 13:34 says, "A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another." So now, what is it to truly love a person? Okay, let's go over to John 14:21. So now, we're going to go up to verse 20. It says, "At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you." So, yes, Christ is talking about another day, but let's just deal with a day to where there is a situation to where you're saying something different. Because I've seen Satan break up a lot of brothers, break up cities, several churches, because men can't say the same thing at the same time. Now, I'm not saying allow somebody to bring in another doctrine or some form of heresy. That's not what I'm saying. The commandments were written in what? Stone. They don't change. So, the commandments, we ain't going to say two different things about the commandments. And we ain't going to strive about the law. Because it says what it says, thou shalt not. And anything that you can do, it tells you what you can do. It's easy and plainly to be understood. Now, if you want that wisdom of the commandments, keep them. And the Lord said he'll give her unto you. He'll give you that wisdom. But remember, that wisdom come how? Not so much as by opportunity of learning. That's true, too. But wisdom come how, yes?
By experience.
So if you burning it up, if you make a, now I don't want to say make a mistake, because everybody wants what they're doing wrong to be an error. So let's say not it was an error. stop lying, saying it was an error. Right? Israel just hardened. And you got to forsake the sin. You got to work on yourself. So, so we don't get too far. Verse 21, it says, he that have my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. So why did I get this? Is because you get into a situation to where you're saying something different. Let's go back into the commandments of Christ, which is important. And that's how you love somebody. You're going to apply the scriptures for them. You got to be keeping the commandments. And the commandments, man, it's your whole walk. It's your say in life. It's your self. It's got something to do with your eyes, your countenance. You got to even control your countenance when you're talking to somebody. Your words, foolish jesting. You know, you can't be foolish jesting. You can't use profanity. Like, you know, you're in a conversation with somebody. You ever notice you're in a conversation with somebody, and excuse me, I'm going to use it for educational and edification purposes. You get to saying shit, damn, fuck. You get to saying that. And they say something about it. And you like, what? What? Why? Why? You want to know why they had something to say? Use your profanity. And you like, well, ass is not a curse word. See? You get this going off like that. See, these. Why? What scripture? Well, just paraphrase it. What a call for that profanity. Paraphrase it means just quote something. Okay. What? Okay. Evil means, okay, you did something that you broke a law. That you can use that if you can get that off. The scripture is always right. Okay. Something else. I got one. I want something from you.
A soft answer.
Okay. You can use that soft answer turned away right out. What about, oh, look, what if, so we can move on. What about foolish jesting? What is jesting? A gesture. Foolish jesting, which is what? Not convenient. Convenient means it's not appropriate right now. So how you want me to take that very smoothly, like, oh, this is a convenient situation? This ain't a convenient situation, man. This is kind of like a fight, an argument, disagreement. This is kind of hostile. Now you're putting words that are not convenient in there. But that which is good for the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. You want the person you're talking to know that they have the grace of the Lord. Okay? They have your grace too. Listen, brother. You got me. I'm here to help you. This is what I see. You don't want them to be offended in you. If I would eat meat, you understand? I would not eat meat if it's going to offend my brother. Whatever's going to offend my brother, whatever's going to offend my sister, don't do it. So there's no way we can justify profanity if it's going to offend somebody. Can't justify profanity, period. We're supposed to be diminishing, killing those works of the flesh because it ain't about us. We can't be emotional. We have to be spiritual. They that are Christ have crucified the affections and the lust thereof, and set their desires on what? On high, where the Most High is. Okay? So, you had something quick.
Yeah, I just like, man, because mainly it's a stumbling block to the hearers, and like the scripture talk about, basically the point is that it's a serious stumbling block, and Israel do buy off that when you use profanity, and the Most High told us to lay aside every way.
Right. Okay, so John 13:33, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I've loved you, that you teach one another, that you instruct one another, that you use the scriptures to edify one another. That's real love. Here's our point. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. When you take time out to use the scriptures, I want to hear what you got to say. I don't want your words. We'll talk the scriptures. When you do that with charity, they're going to know that you are Christ's people. They can tell the difference between you and somebody else. And this ain't a competition. It's just the work that we were assigned to. Know the difference. I talked to this brother with Texan, and the statement that he made is the statement that through the Spirit I would like for all of you to experience and for all of you to be able to have this commendation, although all the praises go to the Most High, because it's about making a difference in somebody's life for somebody. This is how you work out your salvation. This brother said, I've been confused. I've been doing this for a while. I've had many different teachers. You've helped me in this short amount of time more than I've ever had anybody to help me. All praises. I really appreciate it. I might have been going back and forth with him for an hour because we were via text. Just a random, I just asked the brother, when somebody say on Facebook, somebody send me a friend request, I'm there for one purpose. They there to socialize. Facebook is wicked. It's another portion of the world. Okay? At the same time, because we are who we are, we kind of cleave to people that are saying, well, I know I'm an Israelite. I love the Most High. I believe in Christ. Some don't believe in Christ. It's the same stuff went on during his time. Okay, fine. One of the things that I do is I ask a brother, well, listen, how you doing? Do you have brothers there to fellowship with you? Most of them be like, no. Okay. Well, this one brother was like, no. So then I began to help him, because when we don't have fellowship and we are alone, Facebook ain't fellowship. I'm sorry to tell you. People will, and if you're on Facebook, you will know. You'll be wondering, they on there using profanity. They on there doing all kind of stuff. Agree to disagree. It's madness. I think the point is, so I don't go too far away. We want to help people's lives. People are going to know that you're Christ's disciple when you come out the scriptures. Do we understand it? When you come out the scriptures, they're going to know that you are Christ's disciples when you show love to them. When you talk to them about applying the scriptures and you encourage them and you inspire them and you help them not be impartial. They could be wrong. Okay? But you don't have to use certain scriptures to call them a dog. You don't have to use certain scriptures that's going to cut them. Use something to edify them. Use something to show them how to overcome certain things. Let them know how this ended up like this because of that. You got to be a stronger person. But all of these things got to come out of scriptures. Because if not, then you're going to lose that. You're going to lose them. You can't go off word. Trust me. No, ain't nobody trusting you. I'm going to trust the scriptures. You can't use trust me. believe me, your own words. Don't ever deal with somebody without the scriptures. And if you don't have the scriptures, then make it short so that they don't go off into emotions and you go off into emotions. You get drawn away. Make it short. The scriptures say blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah. Always give it to them. Scriptures say prove all things. Give it to them. Show them where it's at. Like I ain't going to type a whole verse in. I might type the point. Or I might just type where it's at. If you're really interested, the most I try to do with you, this is what I think and how I feel. If you end up dealing with me, the most I try to deal with you. I told you an hour ago not to waver, not to doubt who? Huh, brother? Who did I say don't doubt? Did I say me? Who? I said yourself. So you got to have confidence in yourself on the job that you get. When you go to work for Esau, don't you have permission and authority to be on that job? Okay then, so why don't you feel that you have the authority to be on this job? You should. So naturally, because of the spirit that I have to apply the scriptures and the walk in the way, I have to have this confidence. If you're talking to me, the Most High trying to say something to you. How does the Most High talk? Let's get it. Matthew 10 and 20. How does the Most High talk to us? Matthew 10:20. Matthew 10, verse 20. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. So when we become vessels of honor, the Most High gonna speak to us. It ain't a coincidence, an accident, that your paths cross with other brothers and other sisters. If somebody is speaking to you, the Most High got something to say. Come out of the scriptures. Know the scriptures. That's why you gotta study. Know the scriptures. Use the scriptures. Don't use you. Your life is a done deal. That's over with. You speaking you, that's over. Now you got to speak these precepts. And the thing about it is you have to enjoy doing it too. You can't do it grudgingly. And if you want to get better at it, what should you do? Shy? Keep the commandments. Glad you didn't say video game. No. You know, prestige in this. If you want to get better at what you do, keep the commandments. That's why. Yeah, keep the commandments. Yeah, keep them towards another brother. What's one of the number one things that we should be doing? We should refrain ourselves from. High on the list. Might not be the number one thing that we should refrain ourselves from. See, we know the number one thing is to love the Most High with all your heart, mind, and soul. What's the number one thing you should refrain from? Okay, that's one guess. He said pride. What's another? Come on, Josh. First Corinthians. Thirteen. And verse 8, we're going to just get bits and pieces so I can try and establish this point. Because getting it to say exactly what we want it to say might not happen. But let's use logic. Okay? 1 Corinthians 13 and 8, it says, charity thinketh no evil. Charity never faileth. Okay? So if charity is never going to fail, one of the attributes of charity is at the end of verse 5. It does what? Thinketh no evil. So now, if we're not thinking evil, doesn't that change a whole lot on how you deal with a person, on the words that you use, and things like that? That's why I said that's one of the number one things that you have to refrain yourself from doing is thinking evil. Because if you're not thinking evil, it allows your mind to bring forth what? Good fruit. It allows your mouth to be seasoned. If you're not thinking evil, it allows you to be patient. It allows you to be kind. It allows you to be long-suffering. If you're not thinking evil, so that's why, that's what made me say one of the high things on the list, man, you got to refrain yourself from thinking evil about a brother and sister that might not know, that's doing something wrong, that's saying something wrong. You can't go into your personal emotion, because the true worship and service of Most High, we don't have that lust for envy. We don't have that type of spirit in us to where we want to destroy somebody by thinking evil of them. We just want to support. We want to try and be a help. And when a person see that you want to try and be a help, they're more susceptible to allow you to actually go into the scriptures and show them. Okay? So you had something?
Real quick, just, and I was going to say, and then the conclusion of these things is going to cause us to bring forth righteous judgment. Because being able to help somebody by using the scriptures, you want to be able to see clearly on how to help this person, and then that person, like the brother said, is going to be susceptible to let you help them, because thinking evil is bringing forth surmise, and that's what evil thinking brings forth when you deal with each other. It brings forth evil surmise, where it causes Satan to come in, and we have a suspicion. We start to speculate. We start to play out in our mind how this person is wrong or something, and that's what we can.
Right. Okay, so let's kind of get back on track. We've got quite a bit to lose. So we know flesh and blood. So we had some, we was holding the Psalms, right? I didn't write it down. What Psalms was that? Okay. I'm at 35. Psalms 135 and 2. Hey, something just came to mind. Did you know that if you install fear in the hearts of people, they'll be cowardly? I don't want to go away, or else I will pull precepts and examples. So I'm just going to say it. If you install fear, like remember Elisha, how he was, and the men that was with him, they had fear in them. But he didn't install that. But their hearts was almost melted to the point to where he had to pray the Lord that the eyes of his servants were opened up, that they see the army of Israel that filled the mountains. Okay? So now, you've got an innumerable amount, you have an innumerable number of help in the spirit that are all around you, that occupy the same existence, that occupy the same space that you live in. Believe that, because that's in the scriptures. Now, we don't do a lot of Esau gonna kill us, Esau gonna destroy us, Esau gonna chip us, Esau gonna new world order us. And you get a lot of that in this world. And that takes away a lot of things that Esau plots in the world is informative to a degree. But to sit here, Esau ain't never been our problem. He ruled during the time of Christ. And he had control then. And Christ lived in brutal times. The man didn't break in the house. He didn't murder nobody. He didn't steal from anybody. And Esau allowed a bunch of wicked Israelites to kidnap the man, bring him to justice, and hang him. What in the scriptures did Christ teach New World Order? Or to worry about Esau and what this and that? No, he didn't. I mean, but there was a warning that he did tell Israel when to leave. But those were they that was following them and that would listen. So the point is, I'm going to teach you to serve the Lord and keep the commandments and to repent. I'm going to teach you to be the servants of the Lord so that you can go out and teach other people to turn from sin and how to praise the Most High. You're not going to get a lot of Esau from me because Christ didn't give that to me to do. I'm going to give you what I was given. As far as the world and the nations, take no thought for tomorrow. It shall take thought of itself. If the Most High can deliver Daniel out of a lion's den, the three holy angels from a burning furnace, the miracles of the Most High is unlimited. The Most High got you. The Most High will look out and take care of you. Okay, so Psalms 135, he that stand in the house of the Lord and in his courts, and in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good, sing praises unto his name, for it is pleasant. For the Lord hath chosen Jacob unto himself and Israel for his peculiar treasure. So you have to act like a treasure and be those servants of the Father. Let's get Ephesians 3. A lot of times you get people, they spend so much time taking thought for tomorrow that they forget to deal with today. And what's going on today? They need to get certain things together. Today I need to be a better father. I'm sitting here worried about what Esau's going to do. I don't even entertain that. Because I'm not worried about Esau. I got children acting up. I got to deal with the children. I got to teach them. I got to find more time today to sit down and explain to my children what manner of child they need to be. How to let go of the world. How not to be carnal-minded. Why it's okay to be different. Why it's okay to serve the Lord. And what's wrong with the things that are of this world. I'm going to worry about that tomorrow. Can't. This is not saying I got these issues, but this is how we have to think, to keep things in perspective. We got a wife that's slacking. Wife, you slacking. You got a husband that's slacking. You got to do work on him, according to Corinthians 7. You got to try and save him. Use the scriptures, the ones that he showed you and the ones written right in front of your face and the ones that you get in this class. Coming to these classes is the best thing that could ever happen unto you. This is more valuable than gold. Because here you have fellowship of the Spirit, which that's what it takes. Without fellowship, you can't make it. The Spirit say, woe to him that is alone. When you need help, who's going to be there? For Ecclesiastes, you don't have none to help you. When you're going on, who you got? Somebody that you in war down? A wife you in war down? She's tired of trying to correct you to the point to where she just tried to accept who you are. That happened to me. My wife said, I'm just gonna accept it. I heard those words, I'm like, wait a minute. Dang, I must be wrong then. No, you don't. I'm not gonna make you accept nothing. If I'm wrong, I'm sorry. I'm just gonna accept it. No, you not. No. I had to say, stop. You must be bad, man. You can't be like that. You got to change that. So I began to actually work on it. That's how I know it can be done. And straight pay attention. Before I go into a circumstance or situation to where I'm going to open my mouth, I'm going to prepare myself. So let me feel like this. Let me think like this. Let me not do any of the things that caused friction before. Because you can't make somebody accept you and you in the wrong. You can't do that. But no, don't ever do that. I'm going to accept how you is and the person wrong. You keep correcting them. The thing is, you got to be long-suffering. And you got to realize that a lot of stuff that happens, it comes through patience. It ain't an overnight fix. You know, some of us have been building houses for years. And we still build it. So, Ephesians 3. For this cause I call the prisoner of Christ for you Gentiles. Why Paul considered himself a prisoner? He considered himself a prisoner in the truth, in Christ. You should too. There's nowhere to go. Any place or anything outside of this is destructive. It's not worth it. You can't liken a life outside of Christ to a life inside of Christ. Because this is mercy right here. This is the grace of the Lord. Your health flourishes. And if it's not flourishing, then you know what? You need to start repenting and applying the scriptures, forsaking these sins and meddling with these things no more. And you need to start taking the advice that comes from what? The servants of the Most High that are around you that are trying to talk to you. Because the Most High is trying to talk to you. So consider yourself a prisoner into this. If ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of the Most High, which is given me to you, so I'm putting you in that situation. I'm going to put us in that seat to where Paul is. Why did the Most High give us the dispensation of grace? To give it to other people. Not to just be ordinary. Not to just be just like them. But to help them to be strong. You have to be stronger than the world. Verse 3. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery. So that's saying the Pharisees that Paul said that he came from, he's claiming that they didn't teach him, and they didn't. They taught him to be murderous. So what your parents taught you in the flesh, that ain't going to work. What your aunties and your grandmothers, that ain't going to work. You can't mix that in with a recipe. The recipe is good, but what about the behavior that went on in their house? Defiling the Sabbath, eating unclean foods, letting you, if you're a female, letting you have boyfriends, if you're a male, letting you have girlfriends, wickedness. Traditions, all that teaching, that which is flesh is flesh. That's garbage. That ain't good. So through revelation, revealing the truth unto you, through the Spirit, Christ is teaching you. You got to accept those teachings, just like Paul did. Verse 4, it says, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. So when you read about the things pertaining to Paul, which takes some studying, you're going to understand that Christ continued to deal with him. Christ continued to direct him left, right, have him go to this church, have him go to that church. Have him deal with this brother. Have him deal with that brother. Likewise with you. And not just sit here forever learning. Because you can't do that. You can't make it like that. This ain't the system in the world, philosophy and religion, to where you just sit there and you don't do the work yourself. You go to Baptist church, man, those attendants, they've been there all those years and never take on the role of a true brother or a true sister to where they're helping each other. The same dude, just stand behind there. No. It's not like that. You got to do work. So you're in classes learning to instruct, to teach, to guide, to counsel, all of these different gifts the Most High through Christ gives to you. And a lot of us in growing stages, you got to continue to grow. And that ministry will come. You got to be patient and waiting for it. Verse 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. So it's a lot of things that the people of Israel, they didn't have. But now it's being known and it's being given unto us because we're being taught. We're being taught that all sin is abomination. All sin is wicked. If it's wrong, it's wrong. There is no justification for it. And we have to make sure that we constantly walk in the will of the Most High and acknowledge that us being the apostles and prophet of the Lord, we don't cleave to the flesh. We have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness. We don't let that inside of our mind. You can't do that. Because if we let our mind go astray, then we go astray. And a lot of people, they don't really realize that they, when their mind goes astray and their mind go off and commit fornication in a thousand different ways, it's not just a physical sexual fornication, but they can fornicate with different religions. That's why they be accepting Islam and Catholicism and all kind of foolishness, atheism and you can't let yourself go astray from that. It's an abomination. All right. Verse 6 says that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs. So we bring this up to today, the Gentiles will be who? Israel in the Gentile state of mind. What's the deal with them? Mr. Prophet. Miss Prophetess, what's the deal with the Gentile? They are fellow heir. So if they are fellow heir, then treat them with respect. Okay? Honor them how? By applying the scriptures towards them and teaching the scriptures. But first and foremost, your behavior got to be on point. It says, and of the same body. So are you supposed to treat them differently or look at them differently? This precept here says, and of the same body. So that means they in there with you. What's one of the number one things we have to refrain from? Thinking evil. See? Right. Thinking evil, you won't be like, you ain't a part of this. I hope you die. Y'all going to get killed. Now, we know that destruction is going to come to two-thirds of our people. But you don't know what two-thirds. See? You don't know what two-thirds. And you don't know who the Most High going to wake up. Like Christ had to tell that to Nicodemus in John 3. Right? In John 3. Right, he had to tell that to Nicodemus about the wind, how it blow wherever it wants, so the spirit of the Most High. So it's hard to say, oh, this person going to wake up, because you might deal with somebody that seemed to be getting it, and then next thing you know, they don't get it. And then you deal with some people that you think ain't going to make it, and next thing you know, they totally revive. They come around. Beep, 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 beep. They have a heartbeat now. Okay? Can these dry bones live? Most High is asking Ezekiel about that. About the valley of the dry bones. He's talking about these Gentiles. Talking about us, Israelites. So it's hard to tell. the best thing for us to do is to make ourselves a complete soldier in Christ and harden yourself with the scripture, like Teflon, tougher than Teflon. Be spiritual. Put on the armor of the Most High that you may be able to withstand the wiles of the devil. Because one of the top, another top thing is to hate your brother. You're going to hate your brother. You're going to love your brother. You're going to show him the scriptures, and if he don't want to hear it, then so we let your peace return back unto you. So, okay, brother, leave it like that. And that's it. And but the one that you do that and you deal right with, they're going to know that you come from the Most High. You're like, oh, okay, brother. Man, I needed that. They say it's just your job to give them the things that they need. Not so much as, you know, the more they come, the more you feed them. That's fine. It's their job to work out their salvation. It's your job to constantly feed them if needed, but you got to do it lawfully. Okay, that's what he taught this in Corinth, Paul did. He obviously had a real spirit to where he humbled himself for Yahushua to give him the Most High, Christ to give him so much wisdom to where he dealt with all these churches like that. And in their state of mind that they were in, they were all over the place. This is the job that we have because we deal with a lot of different people that's all over the place mentally. And that's why you stay one way. One way is this doctrine here. And those that's meant gonna come to it. Those that don't come to it, it's nothing you can do about that. Don't try and force that. We dealt with some man in the Home Depot the other day. See how we stated the scriptures. When it's all said and done, listen, man, these are the scriptures. And we was polite about it. We just stayed in the scriptures. He was all over the place. He tried to get emotional. Said, no, nope, that don't work here. It's tough. He tried to go back and forth about the heart. I say, no, the heart is in your mind. The heart is the mind, man, according to the scriptures. It ain't got nothing to do with that vessel in your chest cavity. After so long, it's like, all right, brother, I got my peace with me. I'm going to go. He's like, oh, I know you want to go, because he know he was going off. Then he said, well, I'm going to humble myself. I said, okay, well, if you're going to humble yourself to admit that the vessel in your chest only pumps blood. It can't even think. The man tried to say that the organ in his chest could think. Then he tried to say that up. Who can think from their chest? Your brain sends signals unto that vessel. That's what makes it start pumping. If you turn your head away from something scary, does your heart begin to pound? No, it don't. If you turn your face away from something scary, does your heart begin to pound? No, it only pounds when you're looking at it. What's behind your eyes? Your brain. What's inside of your brain? That's what we're calling the heart. Yeah. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. No, it wasn't an argument, and it's a long story. He's got philosophy in his mind. So he was saying something about unity and brothers coming together and black men, that's a lot of black talent, and they all want to come together and build this and that, put a big group corporation together. And I told him that that's hard to do without Christ. And he said that it could be done. I said, no, it can't be done without Christ. So That's kind of what if we put our heart to it, I say you can put anything you want to put to it. But without Christ, it ain't going to happen. It is a lot of talented Israelite men. All right, so verse 7 says, whereby I was made a minister according to the gift of grace of the Most High given unto me. So Paul acknowledged that he was made a minister according to what the Most High wanted him to do. You got to acknowledge that. By the effectual working of his power. What does that mean? By the effectual working of his power. What that means is that you can only do what the Most High wants you to do. It says, unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given. Why did he feel that he was less than least of all the saints? Because of his past and the spirit of humility, to where he's not going to hide, he's not going to mind high things, he's not going to be arrogant. He's going to look at the next brother like this brother is worthy of being saved, because he can remember his actions. That's how you to look at brothers, that they are worthy to be saved. Okay? Is this grace given? So he said it was given to him, it's given to us, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Explain this to me, somebody. The unsearchable riches of Christ. You got some things that are searchable, some things that are unsearchable. Explain the unsearchable part. Why is it unsearchable, and what is it?
It's talking about the grace of Christ. I was unsearchable because it's like never ending. The grace of the Most High that came through Christ is so high that you can never get to the end of it. It's of a great magnitude for never ending.
Okay. However, although those things are true, okay, let me see what he got. Go ahead. Okay. Is that a hand or a white?
White. I did it first, and then white. All right,
go ahead.
When it says, you know, searchable riches, it seems like it's going to say, not riches that you can obtain in the world. It's only given by the Lord. You can only get the riches of Christ through coming up to Christ and serving the Most High. The Most High gives you the Spirit.
Okay, it's something that you experience. Although you can search the scriptures, and not understand it. It seemed like that's what he's referring to. I'll say it again. You can search the scriptures and not understand. You may be like, well, how is that possible? Can somebody describe something to you and you still not understand it until you experience it? Of course. So when you go into the next precept, which I started to have you read that, maybe that would have helped us. It says, and to make all men see, check this out, what is the fellowship of the mystery? So now let's kind of rearrange that. What is the mystery of fellowship? See, fellowship is the glue. I told you how important these classes are. Fellowship is the glue to keeping you in Christ. Because you develop a relationship with what? Okay, with one another. We're going to write this on the board. You develop a relationship with, come on, y'all, with one another. Please, Josh.
You develop a relationship with one another, and you also develop.
That's one. What's two? You develop ship, shot. Aliyah. And you develop a relationship with the Most High. Y'all still ain't get it. What do you need to develop a relationship with? The commandments, the law. See, Israel walked away from this, and in order for them to return, sure enough, they needed grace. They needed grace because according to the Most High, you should be destroyed for being evil. Well, Most High say, I ain't gonna, this is beneath me. I'm not going to be so petty. I'm going to forgive you. But shall we continue in sin that grace may have? So if you're not to continue in sin, to lean on grace, at one point in time, you say, okay, I understand, right? Now I have to return back into what? I have to turn back into the commandments of the Lord. Because returning back into the commandments of the Lord is going to make you acceptable and pleasing in the sight of the Lord, right?
Yeah.
So in doing so, the fellowship is going to constantly be instructing you and reproving you and directing you back to the commandments of the Lord. Okay? So, fellowship is definitely the glue. Without fellowship, you're a through piece. You're a through piece. And that fellowship is going to bring you back unto the commandments. That's the mystery of it. Verse 9, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world have been what? Hid. It have been hid in the Most High who created all things by Christ. Why was it hid? Israel couldn't get it because they didn't see that they actually had to have They actually had to have that love for each other. Let's just use a corner example. If we use a corner example, like you may have five or six guys together and they tight as friends. You know, they have a saying that they thick as thieves, meaning they tight or whatever, right? Don't you know that eventually they kind of like destroy each other, they corrupt each other with bad examples and stuff like that? So that fellowship without Christ is destructive. Fellowship with Christ, with that ingredient that comes from the Most High, it causes us to flourish. It causes unity. It causes us to be on one accord. It causes us to stand corrected. When it gets us help, when things go wrong, and they will go wrong. It ain't no if, and. It will go wrong. Okay, that's why we need that fellowship, so that we can say, hey, did you know fellowship, man, it will save. It will save a brother. That's why when you read in James, let him know that he was converted a sinner from the error of his way. If you have no fellowship, how somebody going to convert you? Scripture says you'll save a soul from what? Death. And hide a multitude of sin. You can't hide sin if you're not fellowship. You can't. To hide it meaning to get rid of it. You can't put it away without fellowshipping. Because everything that you're doing wrong, when you come into that fellowship, that brotherhood, that sisterhood, the congregation, is going to be exposed. And it's not a shame that's going to bring forth, it's going to destroy you, going to bring forth death unto you. It's a shame that's going to eventually polish you up. It's going to beautify you because it's going to purge you. It's going to cleanse you. That's what the Most High talks about. That's what that cleansing, that purging is. And it may feel like chastisement, but it's a cleansing that Israel puts off through this fellowship. He do that to make men see, to know that. That's your job. You to participate in it. And as you begin to grow fruit, you bring them in. So if you care about brothers and sisters around you, you say, hey, this is what we need to be doing. This is what you should be doing. Verse 10, it says, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Now, let's get some understanding. It says, by these things, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places, that's talking about y'all. It's talking about us. It's not talking about in the spirit world. It says, might be known by the church. Who's the church? Oh, the body of Christ, the rest of Israel. The manifold wisdom of God. So the church gets that manifold wisdom of God from the principalities and powers that the Most High put in heavenly places. It's something that's trickling down to the churches. It's not what you think it is. In the spirit world, trickling down unto you. It's trying to get this message and trying to get this example out to the Gentile, to Israel in the Gentile state of mind. To help you understand that, for those of you that have a precept Bible, when it says the principalities, to the intent that now unto the principalities, where does that lead you? Okay, chapter 1, verse 21. That is correct. So let's go there. Okay, so we're going to go up a little bit, right? Ephesians 1:17. Come on. Ephesians 1:17. It says that the God of our Lord, Yahushua Christ, the Father of glory, so it's talking about the Most High, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints. Meaning, what is the Most High investing in the children of Israel? And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe? What do the Most High have the ability to do? He has the ability to turn the prostitute around, the homosexual around, the lesbian around, the thief around, the fornicator, idolater, the whoremonger, the rapist. He has the ability to turn the craziness, those that are schizophrenic, he has the ability to make the blind see and the lame to walk. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe? But the thing is, they have to believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ. So he did all those things in Christ, right? When he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand, where? In the heavenly places. So he said, now that's talking about the heaven, okay? Far above principality and power and might and dominion. So where are those things?
On the earth.
And every name that is named, not only in this world, where is this world at? On the earth. So that's where your principality and power, might, and dominion is. But also in that which is to come. So not only during that time period on the earth, but during this time period, where? On the earth. And have put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to what? Which is his what? Body, which is on the earth. So the body is talking about the people. The church is talking about the people. So let's go back. Remember, some things Paul read are hard to be understood. I know it's a long lesson. We're finishing up. So just be patient. And so you sisters that have the class before this, just know that you have the Sabbath service that comes behind that has to come out. So if you need more time, just say so. More time for your break and so on and so forth. And then we can always pick up. Okay? So Ephesians 3:10, it says, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he proposed in Christ Yahushua our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. So we have this boldness and the confidence that was spoken on, that was given to us by the Savior of Israel. Wherefore, I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. So, don't even faint by your own tribulations. Because if Paul said he went through certain things for us, meaning he went through those things applying the scriptures, so that when he goes through those things and he triumphs through those things, he can come back and tell us how to endure those things. That's what tribulation does for us. And turns out to be what? A glory for that church, a glory for Israel. Because if you show them how to avoid this and you show them how to overcome that, won't they be grateful for that? yeah, they will be grateful. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord, Yahushua. So it goes right back to the beginning. Praise the Most High. For this cause we do. We praise the Most High, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, length, depth, and height, so to be a complete soldier, and how to continue in it, how to continue to grow in every which way that man or woman, according to his ability and office that the Most High give, is capable of growing. And to know the love of Christ, which passed knowledge. See, and to know, so like I said before, you can read and not understand. Because knowledge is written. But the understanding is something that comes from experience. And those things which come from Christ will pass that, that ye might be filled with all fullness of the Most High. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Yahushua throughout all ages, world without end. So let it be. So the work that we have to do, it comes to our patience, our humility, our endurance, our fellowship, and us leading to good works. Okay. So that's it. And we got to get Matthew 26. Matthew 26:6. Now when Christ was in Bethany and Simon, in the house of Simon the leper, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment. She poured it and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? But his ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. When Christ understood it, he said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought the good work upon me. But ye are the poor always with you, but with me ye have not always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, this shall also this, that this woman have done, be told for memorial of her.